The Swift Mansion was built in and around 1892. Its first owners were members of the famous meatpacking industry heirs, Mr. and Mrs. Edward Morris. Miss Morris was the daughter of the late multimillionaire five times over again in Chicagoan, Gustavus F. Swift, founder of the Swift Company, who lived here in Chicago's near Southside, who died and left a Swift family estate valued at $40 million. Mr. Edward Morris, also son of the meatpacking giant Nelson Morris, one of the three leading meatpackers in the world, along with Gustavus F. Swift Sr. At the time of their wedding, Edward was the president and treasurer of his father's meatpacking dynasty, also residents of Chicago's near North Side. This marriage between Edward Morris and Helen Swift was typically the cultural tradition of times in Chicago's upper class. When you've seen it in Chicago's local newspaper, many social parties, mainly among the rich and affluent, from 1890 to 1920. The Swift Mansion is built with its massive stone gray granite exterior, classic-like motifs, and reminiscent of the H&H Richardson architectural style built during the final decade of the 19th century. This was one of the celebrated architects when the Swift Mansion was built, right leading up to the National Columbian Exposition, when the South Side of Chicago was experiencing rapid growth and expansion in economic, social, and real estate architectural development. This architectural and aesthetic value for the Swift was important to keep the property within the family. For instance, the property fell to the father of the late Augustus F. Swift Sr., founder of the Swift Company, who gave the property to his son Herbert L. Swift, and Herbert lived there after his marriage to Miss Bernice Jocelyn in 1901. The family heirloom became the residence to this couple. The national historical significance and the impact of the Swift's packing industry upon the United States are three important national areas: Industrial Revolution, antitrust laws, and African-American migration. Their packing industry business is very relevant in impacting massive migration of African-Americans from farms in the South to urban communities in Chicago and other Midwestern cities, to name only a few: Omaha, Nebraska, Kansas City, Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri, Chicago, Illinois. That Swift located his meatpacking slaughterhouses that were able to create work for African-American farmers that came up from the South. The one important thing that the Swift industry did is the packing industry owners, they owned the majority of them, of these packing industry owners lived in Chicago and was just one of those industries there, one of the big industries that started the Industrial Revolution in America: the automobile industry, the railroad industry, the meat packing industry. This impacted the farming and agricultural industry that drove the economy of the future for the Industrial Revolution age. Swift built stockyards, stock exchanges, and packing and slaughterhouses that engaged a massive migration wave from the South of African Americans seeking for a better life in urban communities throughout America. The African Americans went through the first and second wave of the United States migration, and the packing house industry was one of the many Chicago industrial strengths, and that could provide better paying wages, earning jobs than farmers receiving your wages and annually from agricultural means. The Swift Mansion's history, now the Chicago Packers Millionaires Dynasty, created the economic infrastructure combining almost $533 million worth of value to the economy of America in the Chicago near South Side. The immigration of African Americans exiting from the South, they had a better opportunity in the cities, and this created the first, second, and third waves of African Americans coming to Chicago in most Midwestern cities. Chicago also was an influence on the government of the United States through the packing industry by several lawsuits through the packers from 1892, 1899, 1911, 1919. Chicago packers had to deal with the violating of antitrust laws that allegedly established them as an industrial monopoly. This legal action by the United States Attorney General Palmer's office were two landmark cases. December 29, 1911, December 19, 1919, resulted in a national concern for the Chicago Packers called the Triumvirate. And then later they were called the Big Three, which included the lawsuit where Gustavus F. Swift was mentioned, J. Ogden Armour, and Edward Morris, the one that married Augustus' daughter. The majority of the meetings were held in secret at Gustavus F. Swift's home, end up involving governmental intervention. The deal that they struck in the Southside community of Chicago was valued at $923 million. The United States government established through court an injunction that it violated the federal Sherman Antitrust Act, which limited the Chicago Packers' production of meat, poultry, bread, eggs, cheese, condensed milk, by limiting the railroad refrigerator cars' monopoly until the Supreme Court was able to have a hearing. The transition of ownership of the Swift Mansion that brought it into African-American hands in and around 1930 by one of the viable African-American urban business industries, the funeral home business, known by the company of McGavitt and Sons Funeral Home. This certain group of people purchased the Swift Mansion, as was known in the Chicago Millionaire's Row, for suburban whites from 1860s to 1930s, when African Americans began to populate this area of Chicago. This was an era where African Americans in Chicago began to control the historical architectural wealth of the urban core, as many African American religions began to purchase property for houses of worship in the surrounding communities of Chicago's once prominent Millionaire's Row area of the city. By individuals acquiring, maintaining, and preserving Chicago's historically significant architectural pearls that embodied the history of Chicago's founding fathers' cultural lifestyles that developed out of the two great national events that were held here in Chicago's near South Side, the Columbian Exposition and the Chicago World's Fair. When whites began to move further away from the city, these churches and business owners, by purchasing these properties, the white suburbans allow what you call urban sprawl or white flight, calls white Chicagoans to abandon their forefathers' rich architectural and historical wealth that embodied the story of Chicago's early development from the 1830s to the 1930s. One of the major purchases made, the Swift Mansion, was the start of the local National Urban League here in America. Its inception started in Chicago at the Chicago Mansion at 4500 Michigan Avenue. The Urban League got its start in Chicago at the Swift Mansion by making the purchase. And the Urban League began to work with many African Americans that came up from southern cities to help them to integrate within these northern cities. In the early 40s, several important African American religious leaders developed their genesis within Chicago's Southside Millionaire Row vicinity. The First Church of Deliverance, Reverend Charles Combs, and Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, St. Paul Church of God in Christ, and later both located one block from each other, one block away from the Swift Mansion. They would become a major influence in the religious, social, political landscape of African Americans in Chicago's near South Side. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford, pastor of St. Paul Church of God in Christ, established his church in 1934 on 45th and Wabash, a block from the Swift Mansion in the vicinity of Chicago's South Side, known as Millionaire's Row. Bishop Ford, one of Chicago's African-American pioneering personalities in 1941, purchased Chicago's oldest house, the Widow Clark House, located right behind the historic Swift Mansion, located on 45th and Michigan Avenue. Bishop Lewis Henry Ford accomplished something that would define his legacy as an African-American minister. He became known as one of the great heroes of preserving Chicago's historical heritage. For more than 35 years, he restored and maintained the Widow Clark House. As an African-American, he, as an African-American pioneering clergy, had the foresight to preserve the architectural legacy of Chicago in the early 40s on Chicago's near South Side.